Yeah. He can do it here now. It seems to be working. Why are you, did you turn off there or?
We are rolling.
Okay.
Let's wait 2 seconds. Okay.
Where did the idea of access come from? In this country, it would be easy enough to say it came out of the free speech movement of the 60s, but I think that would be a mistake because we find it, the demand for it all over the world. Electronic media is dominating the communications lanes all over the world, and we find that people are insisting on access. In many other countries, they're using radio. In Spain, for example, they even have illegal television stations. And we're seeing that the desire for access, the demand for access, growing in many European countries. In this country, we've used access to cable television because it happened to be convenient and it gave us a chance to show what we could do on our own channels. And it has been a marvelous rehearsal grounds. And I want to promote the idea of using cable for access. But I don't think this should stop us from spreading the idea to on-air television and radio as well.
Okay. What?
Okay.
Yes.
1 second.
I defined access as the right to have one's own say on electronic media. We are all dominated by electronic media. For the most part, it's a one-way process. But it shouldn't be a one-way process any more than any means of communication should be one-way. So what we're trying to do in access is to give millions of ordinary people the right to use this vehicle to speak with each other and to speak with the public officials who control our lives.
Okay, great. And why is access important?
Access is important because unless we have a way of speaking on this dominant means of communication, we're going to be more and more passive consumers of whatever we're given. We're going to have a culture that's dominated by passivity. And we're also going to see fewer and fewer people taking an active part in their local government. I think that access has already, access in cable at least, in the United States has already proven that it can make a very real change in the way local government is conducted. For example, when local boards, school boards, boards of aldermen, council meetings and so forth are put on cable, people can see who is making those decisions in City Hall and can know who they're voting for next time at elections. It also encourages other people to run for those offices. We know that the cost of running a political campaign in this country is growing every year more and more, and that means that only the people who can put up all that money can afford to run. But with cable and eye recognition of those people, we're finding that many ordinary people can run for those offices, and it's beginning to make a very real difference in City Hall.
Okay. The only other thing I was going to ask you, which you sort of covered, I was thinking, how is access important to people, to an entire community, and then to sort of the general, to the nation, to democracy, or to mm-hmm. free speech? So maybe even on a broader scale.
Mm-hmm.
Are we rolling?
Mm-hmm.
Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Democracy is a very fragile thing. I don't know why we assume that when a dictatorial country turns democratic, that it's going to survive easily. It needs nurturing because it's so much easier for a few people to dominate many people than for many people to govern themselves. We're just beginning to learn how this is done. In this country, we're finding that it's a constant battle between the few who can control the means of communication and the many who have the votes, but are lulled into passivity by watching television, listening to radio, and being inactive. Access is one way of getting us all to speak about public affairs, to take a part in public affairs. My own view is that we want to use access to get people to watch television less and get involved in their public affairs more. And the way we use access can stimulate this.
Is there anything that you would want to add on this show, which is mm-hmm. What is Access?
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything that you particularly, or a story
sure.
or something?
Okay. Although we're using cable to deliver this Although we're using cable and satellite to deliver this program to you, I think we want to keep in mind that Access cable is only a useful rehearsal ground. We want to extend the idea of Access to all electronic media, over the air, certainly, networks, certainly, public television, even more certainly. There's no reason why we shouldn't have the same rights on those channels that we have now on Access. I think one of the very good things that's come out of the Access movement here in the last 15 years is that we have proven that ordinary people can make interesting, important television if we're given a chance.
Okay, so the first question is, why is Access a First Amendment issue?
Well, Access is a First Amendment issue because in order for citizens and groups to reach other citizens and other groups in today's society, it's necessary to have access to the mass media. Now, back in the early days of our country, it was possible because communities were relatively small and there were no electronic mass media that predominated information flows, it was possible for citizens to reach each other via pamphlets and leaflets or simply soapboxes on street corners. They could reach most of their fellow citizens and other citizen groups. Today, however, that's not possible. It's not a meaningful way to reach most of your fellow citizens by placing a soapbox on a street corner and speaking to anybody that passes, because you're not going to reach that many people. The only way you're going to reach most of your fellow citizens, the only way community groups are going to speak to each other, is via the mass media, which has become the major way in which information is received by the public today. And in each community throughout the country, there is usually very limited opportunities to speak over the mass medium. With the advent of television, over-the-air television, there were frequencies, because frequencies were limited, only a few broadcasters could be licensed per community. And the federal government decided that broadcasters did not have to provide access to third parties on a routine basis. There are broadcasters are subject to a public trustee obligation called the Fairness Doctrine, which requires them to provide reasonable coverage of controversial issues of public importance and to provide reasonable opportunity for contrasting viewpoints, as well as sometimes to allow third parties to come on the air. But by and large, with over-the-air television, because of the scarcity of frequencies, it was impossible to allow anybody to get on the television and speak to the rest of the community. However, cable television is a different matter. Cable is different from over-the-air television because of the vast channel capacity of cable. Many of the newer systems have well over 50 channels, some have over 100 channels. And so it's now possible for citizens to speak to one another via the television. And the way that's done is via access channels. Now, why is it necessary to have a right of access to certain cable channels? Because in each community, there is normally only one cable operator. Economic characteristics of the cable industry usually have dictated that only one cable system can financially survive per community. It's a natural monopoly industry, so to speak. And so there is only one cable system per community. Well, if that one system operator has complete control over all 100 channels, then that information gatekeeper can control the diversity of information that's available in that community. And that information gatekeeper, the cable operator, may, for arbitrary reasons, absent any kind of access requirements, exclude viewpoints with which the cable operator disagrees, or perhaps exclude programming that may compete with the cable operator's own programming. In the cable industry today, there's a great deal of vertical integration. In addition to the fact that there is only one system per community, most of the systems around the country these days are owned by large multimedia corporate conglomerates, such as Time Inc., which also happen to own cable programming services. For example, in Manhattan, you have Manhattan Cable offering service in Lower Manhattan, the only cable operator in Lower Manhattan. It also is owned by a company called American Television and Communications Company, which is a company that owns many systems around the country. And that company, in turn, is owned by Time Inc. Now, Time Inc. also provides two pay cable movie services, HBO and Cinemax. Those are the only two pay TV movie services available over Manhattan cable system. Disney Channel, Showtime, other pay TV movie services that are unaffiliated with the cable, with Time Inc., are not carried over Manhattan cable. So to get back to the major point, a cable operator is an information gatekeeper and may control access to the electronic public forum in each community, unless there are some sort of access requirements imposed that allow individuals and groups and programming services access to certain channels on a first-come, first-served basis, content-neutral basis, beyond the editorial control of the cable operator. And the Supreme Court has said that the First Amendment is founded on the principle that the public is best served by the maximum diversification of information in our society. And the only way that information diversity goal is going to be served in today's society, in my view, is by having some sort of access, right of access, to at least a certain number of cable channels in any community, because there's only one cable system. The cable the cable system is effectively the electronic public forum. It serves the same purposes as the public streets did before. And access channels provide electronic soapboxes. So that's really why access is a First Amendment issue.
That was really great and comprehensive. That was good. Okay, whenever you're ready.
Please talk.
The question is, what is the First Amendment and how did it become applied?
Have to do with access to cable channels.
Right.
All right. The First Amendment was drafted in the late 19th century. And it basically...
Hold on one second.
I'm sorry, go
ahead. Right? Why don't you start that again, because you said 19th century. Right?
19th century, okay. Yeah, 18th, that's right, okay. Can we start again? All right. The First Amendment...
Why don't you take a breath first, and then so we can sort of say, okay, second take.
Okay, second take.
Ready? Okay, go.
The First Amendment literally prohibits government abridgment of free speech. And when it was drafted in the 18th century... The drafters contemplated that the real danger would come from government action that might abridge free speech rights. However, over the years, it became apparent that the same kind of abridgment of free speech rights could come about through undue control of various mass media outlets by private parties. For example, the Associated Press in the 20th century is a membership corporation comprised of many of the newspapers around the country. And in the 1940s, the Associated Press, which at that time comprised about 1,200 of the 1,800 newspapers in the United States, had a bylaw, several bylaws, that required each member paper, each of those 1,200 member papers, to only provide their news that they collect to other member newspapers. They could, in other words, they could not sell the news to non-AP members, non-Associated Press members. And as a result, many newspapers around the country that were not members of the Associated Press were placed at a competitive disadvantage. They were effectively denied access to the information, the unique information sources available through the Associated Press. And moreover, they could not join the Associated Press as member newspapers, because if they were in a town where there was already an existing AP member newspaper, that existing member could veto their applications. Justice Department, United States Justice Department, brought an antitrust suit, and the Supreme Court held that those bylaws limiting the dissemination of news to non-AP members and also allowing existing members to veto prospective applications violated the federal antitrust laws. The Associated Press and its member newspapers said, hey, wait a minute, this is an abridgment of our free speech rights. Here is government prosecuting us, and we're all newspapers. And the Supreme Court said, no, you're misapplying the First Amendment. The First Amendment goal is to promote the maximum possible diversification of information. And your bylaws, limiting the distribution of information, effectively prevent the maximum possible diversification of information. So there the Supreme Court recognized for the first time that private control of mass media outlets would effectively bring about the same problems that government enrichment of free speech would bring about. Now that applies to the cable industry, because in the cable industry you have a very unique economic structure. In every community, you usually have only one cable system. And the reason for that is because cable has certain natural monopoly characteristics that mean that in most places, only one system can financially and economically survive. And as a result, most communities have granted only a single cable franchise. And in each community, therefore, there is one cable operator that controls access to all 50 or 100 channels. The newer systems have many, many channels. And one cable operator controls all of those channels, absent some sort of right of access to those channels. So the same kind of private control of mass media outlets that bothered the Supreme Court in the Associated Press case also should bother the courts in the case of cable operators that try to control every single channel. Now, there's an additional reason why the First Amendment is implicated with regard to cable systems and access channels. Cable operators are not simply companies that started up without any help from the government. In order for them to even build the systems under the public rights of way, and in addition to begin offering services, they had to first go to the local government and obtain a franchise to lay their cables under the public rights of way. And as a result, they are very much closer to government entities than they are to pure private entities. So that fact, coupled with the concern about the undue control over mass media outlets, is why there are First Amendment implications with regard to cable and access channels.
That's great. That's great.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, great timing.
Okay. I think that's better. It's good to be better and all of that. But
Well, we'll see. We might use parts, you know.
You can cut and paste, yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah. We're going to change the tape and put some bars down on it just to...